It's your boy Judea, Black Shalom L'Chaim, purified drink of water. They got it, it's out there. Shouts out to the 12 tribes. I got it, it's right there. Okay, so we was talking about the right field. So this is the beginning of the right fields. And the only reason I'm calling them right field, because we was talking about, right field, excuse me. Because we were talking about the being black in Israel. So what we're going to do now is actually going to talk about some other stuff. And and I know you heard my new, that music I like is all slowed down and or chopped and screwed type. I kind of like it like that for this whole little right field thing. So that's what that's going to be. It's may catch light, may catch low. Either way it go, it got a little soul in it. You know what I mean? So what I'm getting about this whole little right field thing is we're going to talk about Emancipation Proclamation, Emmett Till. We're about to talk about the... hold on, I got a list of stuff right here. We're about to talk about the black codes. We're about to talk about the cold facts. We're about to talk about 40 acres in a mule, poverty, special field order 15, objective 8, and all that stuff. We're about to get into all of that with this right field thing. So that's what that is. And like I said, you're going to stand for Israel, you got to stand for Palestine. If you're going to stand for Palestine, you got to stand for Israel, because we support the people and not the cause. And I hope today found you safer than yesterday did. And I hope tomorrow finds you safer than today and the day before. Like I said, we inside today because we got to be. So that's just what it is. So we're running these right field things. So welcome to the right field. And hey, stop. 20 some videos, man. This right field about the wrong one. So let's get straight into that. So I said I was gonna do this like this. Cue that music I like. American privilege, it keeps blurring my vision. Inherited sickness, I've been beat up to people. Cast that paycheck and spend it all.
President Abraham Lincoln once declared, "My paramount object in this struggle is to save the Union. It is not either to save or to destroy slavery. If I could save the Union without freeing any slaves, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing all the slaves, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing some and leaving others alone, I would also do that. What I do about slavery and the colored race, I do because I believe it helps to save the Union." From the very start of the war, Abraham Lincoln was clear that the goal of the conflict was to preserve the Union. It was not the destruction of slavery. Despite his personal hatred of slavery, Lincoln resisted calls to end slavery in order to keep the people united on the goal of reunification. By the end of 1862, the war was going badly for Lincoln in the North. Thousands were dead. If Lincoln came out to declare that those who died had died for the cause of destroying slavery, public support for the war would have evaporated. For Lincoln and most Northerners, the war was about the Union.
As the war dragged on and the North struggled to break through, attitudes towards ending slavery began to change in the North. Many Northerners saw slavery as a weapon in the Southern war effort. Slaves helped grow the crops in the fields that fed Confederate soldiers, and slaves did the heavy work in Southern army camps. In essence, every slave that did work on the home front allowed a white Southern man to join the Confederate army to fight the Union. As a result, anything that could weaken slavery or the South's ability to use slaves would work to cripple the Confederate war effort and help save Union lives. By the end of 1862, a growing number of Northerners favored action against slavery to help turn the tide of the war.
For Lincoln, the decision to relent and act against slavery was almost forced upon him by the war itself. By 1862, the war was going poorly for the North, and public support for the conflict was weakening. Lincoln needed to strike a blow against the Confederacy to turn the tide of the war before it grew so unpopular that the people would demand an end to it without reunifying the country. To Lincoln, ending slavery became a military and political necessity in order to win the war and preserve the Union. Slavery was a tool that helped the South fight on, meaning slaves were essentially military assets to the Confederacy. By seizing or freeing them, the North could deprive the Confederacy of a vital tool with which to fight the war, which could help wear down the South and bring about an early end to the war.
By the summer of 1862, President Lincoln had privately made the decision to free all enslaved African Americans in the Southern states. Thousands of escaped slaves were already being freed by Union forces as they marched into Confederate territory. However, with the war going poorly, Lincoln was waiting for the right moment to declare emancipation so that the decree would not appear like an act of desperation during a time when the North appeared to be losing the war. The president needed a huge Union victory on the battlefield. That victory came in September 1862 at the Battle of Antietam. While the battle itself was the bloodiest day in American history, Union forces had successfully driven the Army of Northern Virginia into retreat and hurled back the invasion of the North. With a decisive victory, public support for the war improved. Now was the time to declare the emancipation of all slaves in the South, forever and for all time.
On January 1st of 1863, President Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation. The executive order declared that all persons held as slaves within any state in rebellion against the United States shall be then, thenceforward, and forever, free. The proclamation only applied to slaves held in the states that seceded from the Union. So it did not free all slaves in the United States. Slaves held in the Union border states did not receive their freedom when the order was signed. The intention of the order was to emancipate the slaves in the Confederacy as to cripple the Southern war effort and deprive them of the free labor that slavery provided them. As Union troops marched through the Southern states, they seized enslaved African Americans and granted them freedom. Hundreds of thousands more ran away from their masters and sought out Union armies for freedom and protection.
African Americans in the North celebrated the Emancipation Proclamation, and crowds gathered to celebrate outside the White House. Abolitionists saw the order as the first step in their long struggle to wipe slavery away forever. Frederick Douglass declared, "We shout for joy that we live to record this righteous decree." The proclamation also helped convince England to withhold its recognition of the Confederacy. England had already outlawed slavery and opposed the slave trade, so it was hesitant to act against the Union after it had freed slaves in the Confederacy. Without European alliances, the Confederacy would continue to struggle on its own to fight the war. The proclamation also paved the way for Congress to pursue the abolishment of slavery in the United States in the years to come. Just as importantly, the Emancipation Proclamation gave the Civil War a moral purpose. The struggle was no longer purely about the preservation of the Union. It now became a conflict over the future of slavery. A Confederate victory would hurl those freed by the proclamation back into slavery forever. A Union victory would permanently reunify the states as one nation, where slavery was no longer permitted.
From the very beginning of the war, African Americans in the North were eager to help the Union in any way they could. African American men were not permitted to enlist in the Union Army, but thousands volunteered to fight anyway. Disappointed but determined, African Americans waited for their chance. Even Lincoln knew the day would eventually come when Black Americans would be asked to help fight to preserve their country. African Americans found ways to help the war effort. Despite the Union Army not allowing Blacks to serve as soldiers, the Union Navy accepted African Americans as volunteers. Black Americans served onboard U.S. warships in various capacities. Runaway slaves who lived freely in the North volunteered as guides and spies for the Union. These African Americans returned to the South and use their knowledge of the Southern terrain to lead Union forces to their desired locations and provide vital information to Union commanders.
In 1862, shortly before the signing of the Emancipation Proclamation, Congress passed a law that allowed African Americans to serve as soldiers in the Union Army. In all, some 200,000 African Americans served their country, with about 37,000 losing their lives on the battlefield. African American soldiers were organized into separate, segregated regiments. Despite their willingness to die for their country, Black soldiers were not permitted to serve alongside white soldiers on the battlefield. African American regiments were mostly commanded by white officers, and Black soldiers were rarely promoted. At first, African American soldiers were only used for manual labor and rarely saw combat, and they were paid less than white soldiers. Eventually, protests and other forms of civil disobedience secured equal pay for Black soldiers by 1864. By the war's end, African American soldiers made up 10% of all soldiers in the Union Army. African American sailors made up 15% of all sailors in the Union Navy. And African American soldiers made up 6% of all Union casualties.
The most famous African American regiment of the Civil War was the gallant 54th Massachusetts Infantry Regiment. The 54th was the brainchild of Northern abolitionists and Frederick Douglass. Led by Robert Shaw, the son of prominent Massachusetts abolitionists, the soldiers of the 54th saw fierce fighting in the South during the war. On July 18th of 1863, the 54th led an assault on Fort Wagner outside Charleston Harbor in South Carolina. The regiment fought across sand dunes in constant bombardment by enemy shells and battled their way to the top of the fort before they were driven back. The 54th lost nearly half of its men, including Colonel Shaw, who was killed in battle amongst his men and then buried in a mass grave alongside them.
The Confederate government became furious that African Americans were fighting for the Union. Arming African Americans to kill white Southerners was reprehensible to Confederate leaders and Southern citizens. In response, the Confederate military threatened to execute any black Union soldiers captured in battle. White officers who commanded African American troops were threatened to be executed with their men. In some cases, the threat of execution was actually carried out, and African American soldiers captured in battle were shot and killed after they had surrendered. These executions violated the unwritten rule of war that called for the humane treatment of prisoners who had surrendered, and today would be classified as a war crime.
In the South, the story was different. At the beginning of the war, 3.5 million African Americans were enslaved in the Confederacy, making up 30% of the population. Slaves made up the bulk of the Southern workforce, working in plantation fields, mineral mines, and as army nurses and cooks. But in 1864, the Confederate military was running out of men. Some Southerners openly discussed arming slaves as soldiers in the Confederate Army. Others, including Robert E. Lee, even discussed granting freedom to any slaves who volunteered to fight for the Confederate Army. The Confederacy refused to allow African Americans to serve in the Confederate Army due to an intense fear of an armed slave rebellion. For some, arming and training slaves as soldiers meant giving slaves the tools to murder their masters and seek vengeance for slavery. However, by 1865, the Confederacy was desperate enough to finally pass a law that enlisted slaves in the Confederate Army. However, the war ended before these men would see battle. Even Lincoln knew the day would eventually come when black Americans would be asked to help fight to preserve their country.